Good morning, everyone. It is August 2nd, sort of the beginning of August, and one of those wonderful sort of agricultural cross day festivals that celebrate the harvest and things like the first part of the harvest and all sorts of cultures. And kind of signals the beginning of the fabulous Puck Fair in Ireland. I think it's in Ireland. Okay. But anyway, happy that, and I hope you're attuning yourself to the cross quarter season. Just sort of midway between summer and fall. Constance and I have been a little more active, or have been trying to be a little more active up here in Sacramento. And we're doing a regular Monday night magic class at, gee, we're now in our second month of doing that weekly, and other little related events. But Constance and I both kind of spend the week reviewing and preparing ourselves for what we're going to do for those 2 hours for Monday night magic class. Right now we're working on the Thoth, working through the Thoth Tarot and the Book of Thoth. But in doing that, you can imagine that we have 50 plus years of having these subjects sort of be the centerpiece of our life. And like all good magicians, our magic is based upon what we're actually doing at the moment. If you're not applying your magic, or growing your magic, or developing your magic, or experimenting with your magic, with things in your own life, you're not doing magic. You're just running away from life. But anyway, so we've been, as we're going through Crowley's Book of Thoth, which I've always said is a magic book, not a magic book, but a magic book. Okay. It's a different book every time you read it. And every time you read it, or even read sections of it that you thought you've read before, you see 10,000 other things that you never saw the last time you read it. So if you don't have Crowley's Book of Thoth, get it in whatever edition you can get it. And if at first it doesn't make a great deal of sense, because Crowley is trying to tell you absolutely everything about everything that he knew there toward the end of his life, don't worry. Just read it again sometime. Get what you can out of it, and then read it again. But anyway, we've been having to draw upon a rich cornucopia of related material that we've been exposed to and worked with over these almost 50 years of studying this stuff. And so we revisit other things that we apply toward what we're doing at the next Monday night class, and in this case, the Book of Thoth. And in doing so, I was forced to revisit a Crowley work called The Soul of the Desert. and I've talked about the soul of the desert, and I've probably quoted the soul of the desert many times over these last 3 years of our morning meetings. But this one in particular, I thought was worthy of sharing with you, and it's just a portion of the very first little chapter. Chapter one is called The Journey, and it's only just a handful of paragraphs. And I want to share it with you today because it's what's going on. It's what's going on in my mind too. But the title of the book is The Soul of the Desert. And it's dedicated to Soror Alta Via, one who lives in the desert. And there's a quote from Lira 65. I too am the soul of the desert. Thou shalt seek me yet again in the wilderness of sand. That's Lira 65, verse 61. Okay. The journey. The soul is, in its own nature, perfect purity, perfect calm, perfect silence. And as well as a well springs from the very veins of the earth itself, so is the soul nurtured of the blood of God, the ecstasy of things. This soul can never be injured, never marred, never defiled. Yet all things added to it do for a time trouble it. And this is sorrow. To this, language itself bears witness, for all words which mean unhappy mean, first of all, disturbed, disquieted, troubled. The root idea of sorrow is this idea of stirring up. For many a year, man, in his quest for happiness, has traveled a false road. To quench his thirst, he's added salt in ever-increasing quantities to the water of life. To cover the ant heaps of his imagination, he has raised mountains wherein wild beasts and deadly prowl. To cure the itch, he has flayed the patient. To exorcise the ghost, he has evoked the devil. It is the main problem of philosophy, how this began. The rishis, seven that sat on Mount Kailasha, and considered this. Thus they answered that the soul became self-conscious and crying, I am that, became two, even in the act of asserting it was one. Do you get that? Sort of like on the Kabbalistic tree of life, the singularity, one, Kether, the crown, the great what it is, was just fine being one until it wanted to know what it was. And then it reflected itself and said, oh, I am that. Okay. It created two just by doing that. It should have just relaxed and enjoyed the smoothness of its absoluteness. But I digress. This theory may be found not too remote from the truth by whoso returns to that tower upon the ramparts of the soul and beholds the city. But let us leave it to the doctors to discuss the cause of the malady. For the patients, it is enough to know the cure and take it. Abana and Pharpar rivers of Damascus are not worth the simplicity of the Jordan. The prophet has spoken. It is our concern now to obey. And so sweet and so full of virtue are these waters that the first touch thrills the soul with the sure foretaste of its cure. Doubt not, brother. Reason indeed may elaborate the complexities. Are not these the very symptoms of the disease? Use but the rude common sense, heritage of simpler and happier forefathers that they have transmitted to thee by the wand. Well, through generations. The cure of the disease is ease. The cure of dis-ease is ease. Of disquiet, quiet. Of strife, peace. And to attain horsemanship, the study of folio aids not, but the mounting of a horse as the best way to swim, to enter the water and strike out. So it is cool sense, not feverish wisdom, that says to attain quiet, practice quiet. There are men so strong of will, so able to concentrate the mind, to neglect the impressions that they do not wish to receive, that they can withdraw themselves from their surroundings, even when those are as multitudinous and insistent as those of a great city. But for the most part of men, it's best to begin in easier circumstances, to climb the mountain in fine weather before attacking it in the snowstorm. And yet the eager aspirant will answer, provided that the cure is complete, provided that the sickness does not return when the medicine is stopped. Ah, that were hard. So deep-seated is the malady that years after its symptoms have passed, in the very substance of the blood itself, that has made the very fountain of life partaker with it in the sacrament of death. Now, that's kind of a braided, plated sentence, very characteristic of Crowley. And so I'm going to read it again. And yet the eager aspirant will answer, oh, provided that the cure is complete, provided that the sickness does not return when the medicine is stopped. Okay, I'll take that medicine, provided that this, okay. Ah, that were hard. So deep-seated is the malady that years after its symptoms have passed, it seizes on a moment of weakness to blaze out again. It is malarial fever that lurks low, that hides in the very substance of the blood itself, that has made the very fountain of life partaker with it in the sacrament of death. Quote, has a spider found out the communion cup? Unquote. Quote, was a toad in the christening fount? Unquote. No. The remedy cures, surely enough, but not often does it cure once and for all, beyond relapse. But it is simple. Once the symptoms have properly abated, they never return with equal force. And if the patient has but the wit to stretch out the hand for another dose, the fever dies. What is then essential? To cure the patient once, to give him the faith in the efficacy of the remedy, so that perchance he falls sick and no doctor is near, he may be able to cure himself. If thought then be that which troubles the soul, there is but one way to take. Stop thinking. It is the most difficult task that a man can undertake. Give me a fulcrum for my lever, said Archimedes, and I will move the earth. But how, when one is within and part of that very system of motion which one has desired to stop? Newton's first law drops like a headman's axe on the very name of our endeavor. Well for us that this is not true, as it is obvious. For this fact saves us from the resolution of all these is rest. The motion is but in reciprocal pairs. The sum of its vectors is zero. The knot of the universe is a fool's knot, for all it seems Gordian, pull but firmly and it ravels out. This is seemingly that which is all the mischief. Gloomy as the gulf, and the clouds gather angrily in monstrous shapes, the false moon flickers behind them. Abyss upon abyss opens on every hand, darkness and menace. The fierce sound of hostile things. One glimmer of starlight, and behold the golden bridge. Narrow and straight, keen as a razor's edge, and glittering as the sword's blade. A proper bridge, if thou leanest not to right or left. Cross it. Good. But all this is in a dream. Wake. Thou shalt know that altogether, gulf, moon, bridge, dragon, and the rest were but the phantasms of sleep. Howbeit, remember this: to cross the bridge in sleep is the only way to waking. Okay, I thought I would just share that with you today, especially if you've had no exposure to the soul of the desert, Crowley's soul of the desert. It's so short you could just read it through one sitting down, but almost every paragraph is worthy of a lifetime of study and dilation. It's just a wonderful document. That's it for today. It's going to be another a very warm day, hopefully not as warm as yesterday. Hope things are going good for you. Go do something agrarian. Go grind some wheat or pick some first fruits or whatever you do, be good to yourself in doing it. Do what thou wilt, shall be the whole of the law. Love is the law, love and your will.